Tonight we will learn about the Common Core State Standards Initiative, which is sweeping our country. And it's already in most of our schools, unfortunately. And how many out there know that much about Common Core? Do you know? How many people? Raise your hands if you kind of have an idea of what it's about. Good. So we have a good cross-section of people here. We have a legislator. We have, do we have any school board people? Do we have any teachers? Parents? Parents and teachers? Okay. There's a lot of talk about and controversy about these standards instituted in our schools. That is why we're here to talk tonight. Our speaker will be Karen Schroeder of Advocates for Academic Freedom. A former teacher in the public schools, Karen has a master's degree in special ed. She is an education activist, writer, and consultant. Ms. Schroeder also testifies before legislative bodies regarding educational issues, and she was appointed to the Wisconsin Educational Communications Board. So please help me welcome Karen.
Thank you very much for coming today, and I'm glad you are so interested in this topic. Advocates for Academic Freedom was started by mainly a group of conservative teachers who were very upset about what they saw happening to the educational system in the early 1970s. And we started doing our research, and we were just appalled at what we found. And we tried to make some adjustments to our profession within the profession and realized that it was not possible. We were also frustrated because, as conservatives, we really wanted to see the Republican Party have an education chair that would provide information to local political leadership about educational issues so that our membership would be well-informed in a very timely fashion. Because the Democrats do that and helps them to be very successful. The other advantage to that would be that we would have a unified message and unified solutions. I've not had a lot of positive feedback from the Republican parties at the state or the national level on that idea. Therefore, even though Advocates for Academic Freedom is a research group similar to the Heritage Foundation and American for Prosperity and Heartland, we have added that additional component of coming out and trying to motivate and help prepare local members to be involved at the local control of school level. Because the only solution for Common Core is at the local level. Governors and legislators cannot do anything really to stop it. You have been reading all kinds of articles about governors who are trying to stop Common Core. And then when a little time passes and you look into it more deeply, you're discovering that all they're doing is changing the name of that item. What's even more compelling is if you look at the five states that where the governors refused to implement Common Core at the outset, they refused to fund any aspect of Common Core. Yet, Common Core is entering their schools at the local level under a wide variety of names. C-Scope is probably the most commonly heard. Therefore, the only way Common Core and some of these other federal programs that I see you have books about in your back corners are going to be removed from your school is by you at the local level. Now, today's presentation simply talks about Common Core and some of the problems that come with that federal policy. We have an additional presentation called Escaping the Federal Grasp on Our Children and Educational System, which it provides a 16-page booklet, step-by-step information on how you can actually accomplish it, eliminating Common Core at that local level. But first, as you well know, you need some information about Common Core itself. So we're going to get started, I hope. There we go. We're going to talk about a few of the myths of Common Core. One of them is that Common Core is new and innovative. It is not new and it is not innovative. There are several handouts on the back table that you're going to need for this presentation to make sense to you. And one of the handouts is a pink sheet like this. One of the reasons I'm giving you so many handouts is because when somebody goes to all the time and expense to create and publicize an event like this, their goal is that you will go home and talk to at least 10 friends about this issue. And we're all alike, ladies and gentlemen. We all have our opinions. And we don't like it when somebody comes to us and simply says, I don't know why you like that Common Core, it's bad stuff, you should not be liking it. That usually shuts down the conversation. I'm giving you a wide range of handouts. One of them might be of greater interest to a teacher, another to a school board member, another to a parent. So when you sit down with that friend or neighbor, you can say, you know, I was at this conference on Common Core, and this woman said that Common Core is the very same thing as behavior modification from the 1950s. And she gave me this sheet. And at the top of it are the 10 educational goals designed by Benjamin Bloom way back in the 1950s. And everybody hated behavior modification, just like they hate Common Core. And all the parents went out there and they tried to get rid of it and they thought they did, but the truth is all they did is change the name of behavior modification to behavioral objectives. And then we fought it again and they changed the name again to outcome-based education. We fought it again, they changed it again. They changed it to mastery instruction and goals 2000. We fought that and we're right to where we are today. And she said that she can prove that the Common Core goals are the same as the Benjamin Bloom goals. And she's also given us footnotes. On every single page, you have footnotes, the source of where I got this information. Please note that none of the information came from any political site. Every piece of information I'm giving you comes from the original source. That means the piece of legislation itself, Benjamin Bloom himself. This comes from his book on taxonomy of education. So you can, your neighbor can look this stuff up and do your own research. And if you say to that neighbor, now, can you help me prove this lady wrong? People love to prove someone else wrong. And if they're a teacher or someone who knows a lot about the issue, they'll probably read this right away. But if they aren't, the chances of their reading it is greater than if we simply tell them, you've got to read this, it proves that Common Core is wrong and you shouldn't like Common Core. So we're hoping that these handouts will be very useful for you, as well as informative. But Benjamin Bloom was an incredibly important educational expert in the 1950s, and he created these 10 educational goals that are on the top of your pink sheet. And based on those goals, educational policies were shaped. In those days, it was education, behavior modification. And would someone be kind enough to read the bottom of this slide for us? Anyone with a nice booming voice, everyone in the back, and say, yes, ma'am.
Education must, A, control to so much of the individual's behavior that he is described and characterized as a person by these pervasive controlling tendencies, and B, the integration of these beliefs, ideas, and attitudes into a total philosophy or worldview.
All right. This is a gentleman who shaped the behavioral policy and the educational policies of the 1950s. These are his 10 goals. Do these 10 goals match this attitude? If you skim over the 10 goals on the top of the pink sheet, they're sitting on the back counter if you don't have them. Take one of everything, please. Now, ask yourselves as you're reading his goals, how often does he talk about the importance of people, children, acquiring knowledge and developing skills? Does he mention it? Or is he opposed to it? And I have another PowerPoint called Who Are the Educational Experts? And his attitude is polite about your children compared to the attitude of 99.9% of the educational experts who have been shaping our educational policy since Horace Mann. Now, if you look at the bottom of this pink sheet, these are 8 goals that Common Core is based upon. And it says that I got these from a document from the International Baccalaureate Organization. So you've got the website right there. You can look it up yourself and verify all the things that I'm saying. If you look at these 8 goals that the International Baccalaureate said that they used to help write Common Core standards, and you compare those to the 10 goals of Benjamin Bloom, you can see that all they did is get rid of some of the redundancies, use a little more sophisticated language, but the questions are the same. How often do they ask or direct your attention to children acquiring knowledge and developing skills? No more so under Common Core goals than under the goals of Benjamin Bloom. Therefore, I think we have proven that Common Core really is not anything new. It's based on the same foundation. Now, people say that Common Core is essential for a new world, and they focus on the economy, a world economy. But what they're really focusing on when you look at this curriculum is a new world order with one government. And how do we know that? Well, on the bottom of your pink sheet, we talked about my source for the 10 goals. It was this continuum on education. And if you open this, it explains their goals. So you can double check, make sure that when I bullet pointed them that I didn't exaggerate. And then they explain that the goals for Common Core standards are based on the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, written by the General Assembly of the United Nations in 1948. Now, when was Benjamin Bloom? 56. Now, Benjamin Bloom's work never says, comes right out and says that he is shaping his ideology on the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights. But when you read his work and you read the declaration, which we're going to look at quickly, you will see that Benjamin Bloom was just as influenced as the International Baccalaureate Organization was when they helped write the Common Core standards. So it says that they use the Universal Declaration of Human Rights with an emphasis on Article 26, because Article 26 defines the standards and value systems that are going to be in the Common Core curriculum. So I went to the website and I got the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It's only a few pages long. And I looked at Article 26, and it says, it defines what those values are. And it says that education shall be available from kindergarten through college to every single student based on merit. Why should we be concerned about that? Well, let's think about this a minute. The federal government has taken over the college funding program. So who gets to define merit? The federal government. And what happened recently when some kids could not, college kids could not pay their college loans? What happened to those college loans? What did the government do to them? They forgave them. So they're conditioning you already for a free college education for everyone based on merit. And the federal government's going to define that merit. Right now, Harvard defines the merit for Harvard. The University of Wisconsin, for the University of Wisconsin, my alma mater, Oxford, defines the standards the merit to get into Oxford. But now the federal government will be doing that. Mm-hmm. Also, the values and goals of Common Core is to have a curriculum that will promote understanding, tolerance, and friendship among all nations, and further the activities of the United Nations for the maintenance of peace. So the curriculum, the English and math curriculum, is going to be encouraging children to believe that a college education should be free to everyone, that it is a civil right, like almost everything is becoming a civil right, and that the United Nations should be responsible for peace, not America. So what does that say about our national sovereignty? And what does that say about our state sovereignty? And actually, this has been a philosophy since Benjamin Bloom, and that's one of the reasons why we are having such difficulty in our nation with illegal immigration. Because we are really, what that issue is really about, is do we have national sovereignty and do we have state sovereignty? Because we are a nation that loves the immigrant, and we have been open to arms to immigrants, and we have an immigration policy that encourages immigration. So it's not that we don't encourage and love our immigrants. This is a whole nother issue. It's a sovereignty issue. So I think we've proven that Common Core is one, nothing new, and we've also looked at pretty strongly whether or not the states wrote Common Core. And the states did not write Common Core. The International Baccalaureate Organization is from a different community, and they're from Sweden, and they are a non-elected body shaping policy in our country. So those are all things about Common Core that you may want to think about and perhaps be concerned about. I also gave you a page that's got my letterhead across the top, and it's 13 points of why Common Core is a problem. Now, our organization is a conservative organization. That means that we value, it looks like this. And again, all those sheets on the back cover we're going to use. Okay. I cannot go into all of these tonight. Many of the things on here are things that we will not be mentioning, and you can look up on your own and use for discussions with friends and family. But as a conservative, we believe in a limited government. That means no federal overreach, that the U.S. Constitution is honored, and our state autonomy and education is honored. We are also people who believe that we should be a nation of laws. So if you look at number 6 on this sheet, with the 13 reasons why we should be concerned about Common Core, it says, Common Core state standards ignore the following federal statutes: the General Education Provisions Act, the Department of Education Act, and the Elementary and Secondary Education Act of 1965, which prohibit the Department of Education from exercising any direction, not writing them, just any direction, or supervision in the selection of textbooks or instructional materials or the control and administration of curriculum. So for a conservative, this is the only issue we need to be opposed to Common Core. It is the only issue we need, because it means, once again, we are no longer a nation of laws. And it means that our U.S. Constitution and our state constitution are being undermined. And for those of us who know the difference between a constitutional republic and a democracy, this offense is so great that we need no other concern about Common Core. You've all heard of FERPA laws, right? Have you all heard of FERPA laws? FERPA, those are the federal regulations that are supposed to protect your privacy. Well, you've heard of the data collection systems, right? Okay. I'm not going to talk a lot about data collection tonight. I'm only going to say this. If you are able to get rid of Common Core, you are going to be getting rid of math and English only. You will not be getting rid of the data collection system. That is an entirely different set of policies and laws. And you are not going to get rid of the biometric testing of your children. That is part of Obamacare, and it's been deemed constitutional. And you are not going to get rid of the health and the objectionable science and social studies curriculum. Those are all separate issues, battles, and pieces of legislation. Common Core is English and math only. So I think we have talked about the fact that in data collection, there's a great concern out there that your child's privacy is going to be undermined, and it is because FERPA laws have been rewritten in the Department of Education, not through Congress. You see, our Congress people have rendered themselves, I'm sorry to be so blunt, but they have rendered themselves insignificant because these organizations, like the Department of Education, created Common Core, which is not a law, it is a policy, but it's implemented like a law. And the Department of Education can create these policies and fund them without any consent from the Congress. In fact, I'm meeting with Senator Ron Johnson tomorrow and his Washington, D.C. staff to talk about that very issue. And our focus is going to be on the fact that the federal government is trying to federalize teacher preparation programs. That's another PowerPoint I have. If you're appalled at what you're hearing today about what's happening to our children, you should hear what's happening to our teachers and what educational experts think of you and your school board members, because that's focused in that presentation. But because they rewrote the FERPA laws within the Department of Education, the data on your children is and will be shared with anyone who is what they call a stakeholder. A stakeholder. That means technically anyone who makes a game that teaches somebody something is a stakeholder. Now, because they did that with the FERPA laws, the General Education Provisions Act, the Department of Education Act, and the Elementary and Secondary Education Act are up for renewal, and guess who's going to be dealing with them? Congress? No. The Department of Education. And so because this limits their power and they've been ignoring it, they're going to be attacking these pieces of legislation and undermining them. So those of us who are frustrated with the policies that come from the Department of Education will have fewer and fewer tools to fight their policies with. So we have proven that Common Core is not new, and it was not written at the state level at all. Also, they say that Common Core is federalizing education. Conservatives say that. And liberals say that's not true. Well, let's look at it. The federal government has used your tax dollars to pay to support the writing of and the promotion of Common Core standards. Then they used your tax dollars to create a curriculum that is aligned with Common Core standards. And then they use your tax dollars to create tests that are aligned with those standards. Now, if that doesn't break these three laws, and if that isn't the federalization of education, what is? Can somebody tell me what federalization of education would be? If it isn't completely controlling the standards, the curriculum, and the tests in the classroom? So the federalization of education is a real issue that is facing many parents out there. John Dewey lived in 1896, and I would like to say that Common Core is just the product of Benjamin Bloom, but actually he goes all the way back to Horace Mann and John Dewey. And the philosophies of these educational experts are shaping the English and the math curriculum in Common Core. Now, Minnesota was smart. They did not adopt a Common Core math curriculum, and we're going to talk about that in a minute. Would someone please be willing to read the screen for us? Ma'am, you were great last time.
John Dewey, the children who know how to think for themselves spoil the harmony of the collective society that is coming, where everyone would be interdependent. Independent, self-reliant people would be a counterproductive anachronism, thank you, in the collective society of the future where people will be defined by their associations.
That has been the educational philosophy since the late 1800s. And that is why I know a lot of us are talking about Common Core standards and what's in them, but you know what? Way back then, we needed to be concerned about what isn't in the standards. In those days, they removed from the standards the teaching that America is a constitutional republic. And we're going to talk about that later. And as you're looking at your health curriculum and thinking about the future science and social studies curriculum, what's missing from those curriculums is just as important as what's in them. But what's in them is based on this philosophy, because this philosophy is basically the same as Benjamin Bloom's. Yes, ma'am.
Can I just ask where that, in history, where did that come from, that concept back in the
I do a presentation called Religion and the Politics of Education. And in 1896, there was a transformation, not just in America, but across the world, of secularism. And Mahatma Gandhi and Golda Meir were key players in trying to stop that. But it was extremely powerful, and it was like a snowball, and it has been rolling down a hill, and it has gotten so huge today, ladies and gentlemen, that this is what you are fighting when you are fighting Common Core. And I will give more examples of that. They said that Common Core was created by states and teachers within those states. And this is just not true. The Aspen Institute was a push for Common Core way back in 1975, and you already heard about the United Nations, didn't you? The Aspen Institute is one of the many institutes that have been shaping educational policy in America. And in 1975, they wrote a very simple 11-page document that's available on the internet called, and I don't have this on your footnotes, but it's called A New Civic Literacy. American Education and Global Interdependence. And in this document, on page 6, they explain, the whole document, the whole 11 pages is a complaint, or it's just a gripe session. They complain about everything from teacher tenure and how the teachers are too stagnant and therefore they have to be retrained every 5 years. That was one of their plans. Getting rid of teacher tenure was one of their suggestions. They said that the school board members were not smart enough, not wise enough, to understand what was facing our children in a global economy. They used a global economy in the beginning. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've had a global economy since the Vikings. And when the Vikings and other people of other nations traveled to trade goods, they knew that they had to, when in Rome, do as the Romans do. Be respectful of that nation. So people have been able to function in a global economy without their help. But these people have said that the school boards cannot deal with the real key issues of education, such as energy, food, raw materials, population control, global environment, communications, trade, investing nationally. And their suggestion for the cure was to federalize education. Another issue they had in here was, in before the federal government was as involved, when these people came up with their ideas and policies, they had to sell them at the school level, the local level. And the parents were involved. They went to the school meetings, they heard the presentations, and the parents and teachers said, no, we don't want that. They saw the flaws in the programs. And they didn't like that. They say it in here, they do not like that. And to get around that, they wanted to federalize education. And they explain one of the key reasons. They say that in America, the students in the classroom is the nation's greatest and most attractive sucker list. Anyone with anything to sell would want to get at this market of future American adults and get at them as early in life as possible. Common Core standards have been accused, and especially the data collection piece has been accused of being manipulated by corporate interests, which it is, and by special interest groups, because they want access to that data. They will make a fortune off of that data. Now, this was 1975, so they've been working at this and it's finally coming to fruition. In 1975, they also, in the Aspen Institute document, defined global interdependence. And it says on page 11, global interdependence will require Americans to give up the dream of the little white house on its own quarter acre of land in suburbia and the permanent loss of personal mobility at will through enforced dependence on public transportation. So even though Common Core has nothing to do with the science curriculum is still federally shaped. It's coming out, a new curriculum is coming out and being introduced in your schools, and you may want to watch that closely as well. So all of these groups, as you can see, have been helping shape Common Core standards. And I just read that to you, so. Now, they say that Common Core standards are rigorous. How many of you have heard of TIMS? Anyone heard of TIMS? Can you tell us what that is, please?
It's a set of standards. It's a way of standards that have been established years ago.
Yes, and do you know, remember what they use the TIMS standards to do?
No.
By chance? How many of you have heard the expression, America ranks 36th in math? You heard something like that?
Yeah.
TIMS is the one who does that ranking.
Is it STEM? TIMS? Does that stand for something? Or is that
Trends in Math and Science Studies. Now, they said that Common Core was internationally benchmarked. And after the conservatives got on this issue, they have finally taken that claim off of their main website. TIMS is internationally benchmarked. That means that every country in the world has said, go ahead and sample test our students and compare our academics with the academics of other nations. The TIMS standards are on the internet free of charge. Now, Minnesota did not adopt the Common Core math standards. As a teacher in Minnesota, I looked at the TIMS standards and I looked at the Minnesota standards, And the Minnesota standards were basically Tim's standards, the first couple of years of No Child Left Behind, but then our kids started doing so well, the kids at the top finally got to have some challenge. And by the time I left, a quick little side story. When I was teaching math in Minnesota, the first year of No Child Left Behind, when we had to do our test, we discovered that we, for the first time in my, at that time I had been teaching about 30 years, for the first time we discovered that we had sixth graders who functioned at seventh and eighth grade math level. But because we all had K-6 certification, they put those sixth grade kids in seventh and eighth grade classrooms, and those seventh and eighth graders were just cruel to those kids. So they had to go to the state and get a waiver for my license so I could teach any grade level of math to sixth grade students. By the time I retired from teaching, I had two classes of sixth graders functioning at a ninth grade level, two classes at an eighth grade level, one class at a seventh grade level, and several other teachers had students who were functioning at seventh and eighth grade math. So Minnesota was very smart in not adopting the Common Core math standards, because what they had was doing so well for their students at the time. Now, Minnesota has adopted the Common Core English standards, however. The federal government paid $16 billion with a B. $16 billion to create, support, and promote Common Core standards. The TIM standards were free. And you have a yellow sheet of paper. Have you heard of Dr. Sandra Stotsky? Anyone heard of Dr. Sandra Stotsky? Yes. She wrote a set of English standards for the state of Massachusetts. Now, if our states were doing their job, and our states were truly writing the academic standards for that state, the state would have put in their search engine which state outperforms all others in math and English, and up would have shot Massachusetts. For 10 years running before Common Core, the students in Massachusetts outperformed all other states in reading, math, English, and science. And if you went to their website, their state website, it said, "These standards are free to any state or school district." So if you're a conservative and you believe in fiscal responsibility, this alone is enough to make your head hot. Think, $16 billion, that money came from our states originally. Think of what our states could accomplish if the federal government did not have the right to take that money from us in the first place. Think of how much more we could pay our teachers, how many more classes and types of opportunities we could provide our students. Think of how much smaller our class. Think of what we could do as a state with that. Instead, they created a set of standards that are objectionable, that are illegal, and that are inferior to free standards that are out there. Now, if you look at this yellow sheet, this is Dr. Sandra Stotsky's summary of all the reasons why the Common Core standards are flawed. So if you are looking at your child's textbooks, put this next to them and use it as a guide, kind of a check off to see if it is true, if you believe that the Common Core English standards in your school is really missing these concepts. Now, they said that Common Core standards was written by teachers and states, right? We've talked about this several times already. Well, I did a little research and I went through and found all the companies that were involved in some way with funding or promoting or writing Common Core standards. I had 12 slides. You can't do that in a PowerPoint presentation. You guys would be so bored looking at 12 slides of a bunch of logos. So So I condensed it to one slide because, and I didn't put Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation on here because everybody knows about Bill and Melinda Gates and their incredible involvement in this process. And it just amazes me because people say, well, they're conservative, and they are not conservatives at all. There's not conservative money in there. But anyhow, people say, well, because the National Governors Association endorsed Common Core, it is therefore state-supported and state-created. Pshaw. If you look at the IRS filings of the National Governors Association, 80% of their revenue comes from tax dollars. Of that 80%, 40% comes from the federal government. Now think about your schools. Depending upon the economic status of the students in your schools get anywhere from 3% to 7% federal money. But look at how much control they have over your schools for that little bit of revenue. Imagine how much control they have over the national governors. And we will talk more about that later as we look at an educational expert who spoke at a National Governors Association. CCSSO, Council of Chief State School Officers. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is what we call an NGO. It's affiliated with the United Nations. And because it's an NGO, you can't even file a Freedom of Information Act and get any information on this organization. But your tax dollars help fund that organization. We don't know how much. Non-government organization. Now, look at all of the educational institutions and the businesses. And one of the things you need to ask yourself as you're doing your own research on Common Core is, why do all of these companies want to invest in education? And one of the things as a teacher I find so insulting is the excuse that they have to prepare our children for the workforce. Puff and Shaw. Never in the history of education has education prepared children for the workforce. It can't. It is absolutely impossible. Let's take a simple example. Stillwater. Let's pretend on the north end of town it has a shoe shop. And they create high-end boots and dress shoes for women and men using leathers. And on the south end of town, you have a shoe shop that makes casual shoes out of plastics and other man-made materials. The processes and how those materials are used are so vastly different, there is no way a classroom can prepare those children for that profession. What an education was originally intended to do was to give children the knowledge and the skills they needed to be lifelong learners, to value learning, and then if a child could read, write, do basic math, and communicate well, it was easier for the employer to train them. They became flexible enough for the employer to train. We've had apprenticeship programs from the beginning of time. Employers need to train their own employees. Their own businesses change so rapidly, schools can never possibly keep up with it, and if they cannot handle it financially, it's impossible. And to use that as an excuse for their involvement in this is reprehensible. Because what they're really doing is taking control of our educational system. They're using their lobbying efforts to have the federal government implement goals that they have, including whether or not your children consume corn. They want to use corn for oil to make gas for your cars, so there's not enough of the product, so they don't want the kids eating corn. I have seen that from the Department of Agriculture. They control their markets by manipulating attitudes in our schools. So all of these federal departments have a say in what's going on in our educational system, from the food that is eaten to the quality of materials used in the classroom to the information that's in those textbooks. So Common Core is a symbol of the real problem. The real problem is federal overreach. It's been since Benjamin Bloom, and it is today. And if we want to fight Common Core, we're going to end up right back where we were when we fought behavior modification. Let me put it to you this way. Suppose your neighbor's front yard is filled with dandelions, and he knows you don't like it. So he runs around and he picks up all the flower heads. And he says, there, I solved the problem. Did he solve the problem? No. What's happened? That rut has gotten deeper and stronger and healthier. And next week, every one of those plants produces multiple flower heads. So when we go after Common Core, we're picking flower heads. The real solution is to talk to your state legislators and have them hold our federal level legislators accountable to limit the federal Department of Education. Right now it's a cabinet post. It never was until Jimmy Carter. It can go back to a non-cabinet post. It still has plenty of power. The Federal Department of Education, along with all the other departments, should be funded through Congress. And they should have to follow the laws that are already on the books. That is one start for our federal level legislators. And the other is your vigilance at your local level. You must know what is in those tests, what is in the textbooks. And I will show you an example in a minute. And if something is wrong or false, you have a legal and moral right to have it removed. This is Dr. Shirley McCune. This is 1989. She attended the governor's conference and got a standing ovation for this. Would someone be kind enough to read it for me?
We no longer see the teaching of facts and information as the primary function of education. Building a new kind of people must be a part of the curriculum. More and more schools are the center of all human resource development. The earlier we can intervene in the lives of people, the more effective we can be.
Now, have you seen the theme? Is this really any different than what Benjamin Bloom said? Is it really any different than what John Dewey said? And if I were to bring up, which I don't have time for, I'm going to bring up the person who wrote, who's credited with writing Common Core, David Coleman, you will see that from the 1975, 1950, all the way to the present, the goals are the same. And you, as a parent, have a moral obligation to make sure that your children are prepared for what school was intended to do. Give them the knowledge and skills necessary so they can seek truth. That was the reason people wanted education in the first place. If you look at the Mayflower Compact, and you look at the old deluder Satan laws, which were written in the 1600s, that it was called the old deluder Satan law because the people who wrote that law created the first locally funded educational system. And they said that the reason they were doing this is because when they were kids, they weren't given an opportunity to have an education. And therefore, they could not read the Bible. And because they could not read the Bible, which was the main source of history and literature, that they were robbed of the truth. And they did not want that for their children. Because if our children respect truth and are taught how to find it, even though some truths take a lifetime to truly discover, they will become better employees, better citizens, and better people. And you as citizens have a right to make sure that the children in your community receive those advantages. Yes?
I just have a comment to make that's just, it's so mind-boggling to me what you told us so far, because I know some about Common Core, but not all of it. The part of when it started in the 40s, because I'm old enough to remember well, you know, the whole Cold War thing, all through the 50s and 60s and 70s, and we were fighting the evildoers being the collectivists. That's the part that is mind-boggling to me, is that the collectivists were started it through the UN.
Yep.
And yes, have been doing that in our country all these years.
Well, wait till you see what I've got for you at the very end.
Think of the billions are spent on the Cold War.
Oh, yes. And if you think of all the federal government started in the 50s with Benjamin Bloom supporting standards. From that, they added curriculum. And the Common Core is just the final step because now they're controlling the testing. And I'll show you in a minute why that's so important. Through the Smarter Balance, they're going to be testing your children. State longitudinal data systems are very important. They are not part of Common Core. It's a separate policy and separate legislation. If you get rid of Common Core, you will not get rid of this data collection system. And the real purpose of this data collection system is not for your children. Because there are three U.S. Department of Education studies that prove that this data collection system does not alter academic success for students, and it proves that most of the processes for this data collection actually can cause psychological harm. So a lot of people are connecting the two, but they really are not connected. It's a separate issue. David Coleman of the College Board. David Coleman was in charge of President Obama's data collection system for his second campaign. Do you remember the Democrats talking about how this data collection was so vast and impressive? There's a YouTube video of Maxine Waters talking about how this data collection system is something, a legacy that Obama is going to be leaving the Democrats. Do you remember that at all? You can look up Maxine Waters' Obama data collection system on the internet and see her talk about it at length on YouTube. Well, David Coleman went from developing that data collection system to writing Common Core. President Obama put him in charge of College Board. College Board is the organization that has always created the ACT and the SAT tests that kids take in order to get into college and the advanced placement test. And he says, the Access to Rigor campaign, an Access to Rigor campaign is that data collection system for Obama, promises to be the broad national operation which will complement the massive Obama database already in use. So this data collection system that they're going to be using in our schools will be used to collect data on children for something other than academics. And it is going to be used to fire teachers, to be honest with you. They, remember in 1975, they did not like teachers who had tenure. And that's a long issue. If you look up my name and teacher rights and teachers being fired on the internet, you will see that I have written several articles recently about the number of teachers who are being fired. Look up Karen Schroeder and Our Future, Our Teachers, which is the new Department of Education policy to federalize teacher college preparation programs. And teachers are not going to be able to get a master's unless the federal government says they can. They cannot get a pay raise unless the federal government says they can. That's who I'm. But why I'm meeting with Senator Johnson tomorrow and his Washington, D.C. staff to talk about this. It is absolutely reprehensible. And it's the most racial piece of legislation I have ever seen in my entire life. Look it up on the internet. I think it's like 15 pages. Now, think about some of the things we talked about at the beginning of the presentation from the United Nations. Free education for everyone. Federal government defining merit. Okay. David Coleman says, the College Board will use its existing and future data vault to profile low-income and Latino students from K-12 using the slogan, if they can go, they must go to college. Therefore, we have the first step of merit defined by Mr. Coleman. Now, you can find him saying this on the internet. Look up Harvard presentation, David Coleman, and the whole speech is on the internet. Now, if I were to give you an example of math lessons, I'd lose half my audience. If I were to give you an example of English grammar, I'd lose another part of my audience. But conservatives, and most of us know quite a bit about history. At least we can all relate to history. So I'm going to summarize this by talking about a history lesson, because even though Common Core is English and math only, this has been happening in our schools since, as we said, John Dewey in the late 1890s. Okay. In 1950, or a little bit before, the social studies standards no longer require that children be taught that America is a constitutional republic. Not a single utterance of complaint from anyone about that. So when I was teaching in 1970, our social studies textbook had one sentence about a republic. It was basically a brief definition, and it said America is a republic. The rest of the chapter was on democracies. Okay? Now, because the tests were not federally aligned, teachers like me, who are, by the way, in the process of being purged from our educational system, could bring in factual information and say to the students, boys and girls, we are a constitutional republic. And what that means is that your freedoms are granted in our Constitution, and they're defined as coming from God. And that means that no one can take them from you. And if you are not a believer in God, it means that those freedoms are natural, like the color of your eyes or the height of your body. Nobody can change them or take them from you. And in a constitutional republic, when someone is elected, political parties are not necessary. They can exist, but they don't have much influence. Because when a person is elected to office, they take that oath that says, they will defend and protect the Constitution, which means they represent you, but not you as a person. Not your wishes, not your wants, but your freedoms. So when a bill comes before a legislator in a constitutional republic, they're supposed to ask themselves, if I support this bill, will I be stepping on the freedoms of just one person? And if the answer to that is correct, that legislator is to vote no on that bill, because our founding fathers warned us against being burdened by massive federal legislation, rules, regulations, fees, fines, and taxes. They did not favor that. Then we taught our children that many of the founding fathers warned future generations against ever becoming any form of democracy. We read to them from the letters of those founders that explained all the pitfalls of a democracy. That is a secular government, and what that means for their freedoms and historically speaking. That it usually ends up in mob rule. All right, so the end of the year, the test comes, and sure enough, the question is, because this test was written by an independent group who said to themselves, what is the most basic thing a sixth grader should know about their government? So the question was, what form of government was shaped by the US Constitution? Well, the kids in the classroom of the teachers who brought in that extra information and made those explanations got the question right. But the very talented, capable teachers who believed in those educational experts and followed that book to the letter, they got the answer wrong, and that ticked off the progressive leaders. Okay? But by the 1980s, the textbooks no longer included mention of a republic or a constitutional republic. The textbooks now are teaching that America is a democracy, and she is not. You see, in a democracy, as Benjamin Franklin wittingly said, a democracy is two wolves and a sheep trying to decide what's for dinner. And a republic is a well-armed, literally armed, lamb. You see, they did not want mob rule. In a democracy, when a bill comes before an elected body, they say to themselves, whose money put me here? Whose votes put me here? Who's making the most noise over an issue? And the wants and wishes of those people are granted at the expense of the freedoms of everyone else. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been functioning as a democracy since about the 1970s. We surrendered our constitutional republic in the classroom without shedding a single drop of blood. Now, 2010. This is in a Wisconsin textbook, but I know for a fact that it's used in Minnesota as well. In fact, it's used across the United States. I got this from a parent who is sending his child to a very expensive Catholic private school. You'd think he'd be thrilled because they bring republicanism back into the textbook. The title of the book is American Pageant, and it's written by David M. Kennedy and several other people. And it's used in an advanced placement history class all over the United States, including private schools. This is the definition of republicanism. Now remember, the teachers who are in those classrooms, except for a handful of us, have never seen or heard the word constitutional republic, republic, or republicanism. Okay? And this is the definition. Republicanism is defined as a just society, as one in which all citizens willingly subordinate their private, selfish interests to the common good. So not only are we surrendering our democracy without shedding a drop of blood, but when you think about how long it took to remove the word republic and become a democracy, and this happened in 2010 to completely change the definition of republicanism, think of how long it's going to be before we become that kind of government. Because this is how those kids will be voting. And because it is a federally aligned test, I cannot go in there and tell my children this is the false definition for republicanism. Now, if this test were made at the local or state level, I can, because it's happened in my teaching career, call up the company that made the test, or actually our superintendent does it, and says, listen, this test question, it's not in our curriculum. Let's not count that one this year. Let's put something else in its place. We can do that at a state level, but at a federal level, how do you make this correction? Now, you as citizens have a right to go to your schools and look at the textbooks, and when there's false information in those textbooks, you have a right to demand that that information be removed, and you have an obligation to give them the correct information from a reliable source and ask and demand that they teach the truth. You have a right to do that at the local level. Now, you have a green sheet, Minnesota Statutes Governing Sex Education. I see you've got books back there about sex education. We've been talking about Common Core, but what we're really talking about is the federal involvement in education. Now, it is really important that you know the laws in your state. It's a green sheet, and it says Minnesota statutes governing sex education across the top. They're all in the back home. Wisconsin, and you want to look at what's in your state and compare it to other states. Wisconsin has language that says, for example, the school district should have sex ed curriculum that is abstinence-centered. So when you're a parent and you can take that legislation with you to a school board meeting and say, this is what the law is, and you're not properly implementing the law, you have a greater opportunity to be successful. So you want to become very familiar with your state laws. Minnesota has an excellent local control of schools law that's on your blue sheet. Now you might want to copy, print out this entire legislation. It's about 18 pages in it. Because it defines job descriptions of school board members and your State Department of Instruction and your rights as parents. And it says, the parent of a child is primarily responsible for assuring that the child acquires knowledge and skills that are essential for effective citizenship. Now, that passage I read to you from a history book about republicanism, is that going to help your child be an effective citizen? No. These Common Core math, well, you don't have math in your state, but the English lessons that are completely void of grammar, is that going to help your children be effective citizens? Yes?
I just want to say, I know that our legislative committee did not adopt the math standard, but all of our districts have been infiltrated with Common Core math.
I have been hearing some of that. Now, the district that I taught in, they're still using the good stuff. So I don't know how many districts are being infiltrated, but Texas? Their governor said no. So yes, you have to watch
it. What would you call the good stuff?
The Minnesota had the TIMS based.
Right, I just mean like what
curriculum?
What, yeah.
They
what publisher?
All the publishers have Common Core aligned curriculum and then they have non-Common Core curriculum. So I could give you the name of a publisher and you'd be able to, if you got the wrong textbook, you'd have to look at inside the textbook at the publication date and whether or not it's Common Core aligned. Very excellent question. So knowing the laws of your state is really important. The other thing that you want to know about is, unfortunately, your state has not done this, but you have a right to ask them to. This is the Wisconsin Association of School Boards created this book. It's called A Key Workbook for School Boards. Your state has not created one. This book is absolutely fantastic. It's, you know, Wisconsin's a blue state. Has been for a long time. The educational system is as blue as you can get. There are over 100 quotes in here that I use all the time when I'm addressing school boards in the state of Wisconsin especially. And one of them says that you cannot have a standard-based curriculum. Isn't that what Common Core is?
Yeah.
Standards, okay. Without the support of the community. Another quote from here is, too many school districts implicitly or explicitly indicate to parents that educational decisions must be left to the experts, and this destroys school climate. So instead of having to scold the school boards, I can say, well, may I quote from the Wisconsin Association of School Boards? Now, you don't have this booklet, but you can call them and ask them to create one. But they do have, and you've got a white sheet of paper that says across the top, what is a school board? And this is from a slideshow that they created to train new school board members. It's a white sheet, it's got little dashes and some bullet points. Okay. agency's local resources. Everyone have one? Okay. If you look at the second section, school boards are most effective when they focus the big picture on making policy, setting goals, engaging stakeholders. So if your school district is making decisions without having public hearings or informational meetings, you can hold your feet to the fire and say, look at, when you're trained to be a school board member, this PowerPoint says that you are to involve stakeholders. That's us. This state, Minnesota state law says that we, the parent, are responsible. Why are you taking that from us? You don't have a legal right to take it from us. You don't have a moral right or an ethical right to take it from us. Now let's get down to business. Let's change this curriculum. Yes.
Do you find that people have much success? I tried communicating with one of the school board members in my community with a little feedback from her, and I know she's in the minority on the board in the community I live in, and maybe she just doesn't see that she has any chance of winning against the majority on the board, but I wonder what kind of experience people have, because it's very intimidating. I haven't been to many meetings, but I've watched them on television and you wait for the police to step in at any time and cut you off. That's what it feels like.
Yes, and it's really frustrating. However, I have noticed that I have an ever-growing number of people asking me to come back to do the PowerPoint called Escaping the Federal Grasp on Our Children and Educational System, because that PowerPoint is focused solely on what are the things you can legally do? How do you go about it? And it's a little 16-page booklet everyone gets. So you've got it all right there, sample letters, opt-out forms, everything you could possibly need. Our government is a government by we the people, for the people. We are the people. They put all the power in our hands. And when we acquiesce that power by being docile and complacent, we lose it. And when somebody has the right to make decisions for you, they're not going to give it up easily. When I go speaking to people on that PowerPoint, I start out by saying, you have got to be the modern day George Washington's. Imagine this. George Washington, what if he had said, I'm not going to be the general in this war. The English military is the largest, best trained, best supplied military of any nation on the earth. And I've got a bunch of ragtag farmers who are bringing their own guns, and I've got a fraction of what they've got, and we don't even have all the support of our community behind us, and if I lose, I'm going to be hung for treason and all my property taken from me. What if he had said that? And he had quit. Thank God he didn't. Where would we be today? Instead, he said, if I'm going to win, I am going to have to outsmart, outmaneuver, out-tenacity, which isn't really a word, the British Army. And he did. And he did, thank God. And you are the modern day George Washingtons. You are going to have to outdetermine, outthink, outmaneuver. And you're going to have to use all the tools available to you, and I have just brought you a couple. Just a handful today. But the real solution for Common Core is with you. Your legislators can make sure they don't fund it. When a legislator approves of a funding bill that says X number of dollars will be used to implement some aspect of Common Core, that immediately undermines your right as parents to exercise local control of schools. If they understood local control of schools, and if they followed it, they would write legislation that said X number of dollars would be available to all schools who upgrade their standards. And then all the school districts would have to upgrade their standards, and it would be easier for you to get involved at that level. So, you're going to have to be determined, and you're going to have to start at the local level and rely on yourselves, and you're going to have to monitor that curriculum. And you're going to have to opt out. Opting out is something that is an essential step for many districts in New York and California, districts where anywhere from 3 to 20% of the parents opted out those schools of the tests. The data collected will no longer be valuable for research, and so they decided not to do the testing at all, and they found another test that would work better, and the parents were happy, and the kids didn't have hours and hours and days of testing. So there are many options for you. But I want to thank you so much for inviting me, and I hope you found some good information, something of interest to you, so thank you very much.
I do have questions, but I just wanted to let people know that I'm with Minnesotans Against Common Core, and we do have both a petition back here. If you live in Minnesota, we have a petition here that you can sign, and also we've started school district efforts across the state, and so if you would like to work, help out in your own school district, we would love for you to just sign this. There's you can give us your name, your email address, and what school district you're in, or if your children attend a private Catholic school if they homeschool, what have you. But we need the school district name, and we'll connect you.
And Advocates for Academic Freedom has a petition on the back to get rid of the Federal Department of Education. And if you could sign that and give that to me before I leave, I would really appreciate it. And please print, because I have my eyes are getting bad. Can't read everything that's cursive writing anymore. Yes.
I just want to make a couple of comments. I am on a school board that that woman just described. I am the only conservative on the school board. And I'm in a constant fight with the school board members, the administration, and the community that I live in. I have been threatened twice in the 2 years I've been on that school board, threatened in a written letter from the school board president with removal from the school board. Mm-hmm. They're threatening to remove me. Now, in the state that I'm in, they can only remove me through the voters can do it in a recall, or it can be done through a petitioning a circuit court to remove me, which is what they're threatening me with. But I pointed out to them I have to commit a felony for you to get by to that. So yeah. Right now they're leaving me alone. But I want to tell you that it isn't as easy as you think to fight this.
No.
This is tough stuff. And the reason they're threatening to throw me off the board is because I simply won't shut up about the issues that I see, and they've been trying for 2 years to get me to do that.
We won't let them.
Two threats. The other thing I want to tell you is that when you talk about this testing, I, as a school board member, was brought to my attention about a year ago about a test that had was on technology. And there were some questions on that test that I wondered. All I saw was the test results. And there were some results on there that I wondered, why would they be asking questions about this and this on a technology test? So I went, now remember, I'm on the school board. I went to the administrator and I said, I'd like to see that test. I want to see the test questions, so I can determine why these questions about this subject are on a technology test. I was declined. 2 years, I have been unable to get my hands on those test questions. And this is what the school administrator told me. They are private property of the testing company. They are copyrighted questions. And when I said, well, does that mean that a parent in this district can also not get their hands on the questions?
Yep.
Nope. parents can't see them either.
Okay. This is factually incorrect.
That's what she told me.
Well, she's wrong. This is why
she tried to throw me off the board, because I keep telling her she's wrong.
First of all, if you had conservatives at your school board meeting supporting you, they wouldn't feel so empowered to diminish you and threaten you. Also, if you had more conservatives on your school board, wouldn't be so alone. Also, I'm an author, and I have been for many years. 38 publications carry my work. All my work is copyrighted, ladies and gentlemen. When someone buys my work, they not only get to read it, they get to publish it. And let anybody in there who reads their newspaper read it. The only thing a copyright law does is, it does not allow that newspaper to put someone else's name on my article and take credit for it. That's all it does. It does not allow you to take the article off the internet, which this has happened many times, cut and paste it and send it to another newspaper as a letter to the editor and put your name on it. It doesn't allow a person out there to take my work and sell it for profit, put their name on it or their organization's name on it and sell it for a profit. So the only thing a copyright law does is it says the only person who can make money off of that material is the person who actually created it, and the only person who can have credit is the person who actually created it. You are taxpayers. You paid for those materials. You get to read them by law because you paid for them. You don't get to make copies of them. You don't get to sell them. You don't get to put your name on them, but you get to see them and you get to read them. And if they don't let you, threaten to sue your laws in your school district. Because that is illegal for them to stop you from seeing anything you have paid for. Yes?
I had an interesting situation. It wasn't the NCA, but it was a... I can't think of the name of it. I'll think of it in a second. But anyway, it was a standardized test that they had given my second grader. And they didn't tell us that they were going to do it because I was all ready to opt out of that. And it just happened on the computer and whatnot. So then I had feelings about that and I expressed them and they were shut down very quickly. But that's not really how I work. So I kept at it. And I'm on the, don't respond to the phone calls or emails.
Can we open the store?
Yeah.
But they, I was curious about the test, and I wanted to see it. And the lower school administrator told me that I had no rights to the test because I didn't pay for the test, and the school paid for the test, and so only they had rights to the test when they hadn't even taken it, because she has no idea what's on the test. So then I reminded her about how I actually pay her, and so therefore that test is mine.
Right.
And then she informed me that she was told by the school director not to give me the name of the performance series.
I know what you're
so annoying. That he had instructed her not to give me the name and number because I would just harass whoever the representative was. And so I had gone back and forth, and when I called the department of ed, they weren't really sure about this test, but they said that I did have rights to the MCA scores and the test. And so since this test is not dictated by the state of Minnesota, but this one is, then she just assumed that obviously I would have rights to this because this is not dictated by them. Like, this is an extra test the district decides to throw at them.
Well, several things. First of all, it's very expensive for the school district to purchase the tests. So when they do, even the teachers don't get to see the tests.
Right.
Because
and it's on the computer, so.
Right.
Yeah, but the only ones who get to see the test are the kids taking the test while they're taking the test.
Right. And then the questions are changing for each.
Right, and when I was teaching, thank God, I was so glad. When my math kids were being tested, I wasn't anywhere near them. So I never saw any of the questions. Not only did I not see any of the questions, but my kids did so well, and nobody could say, well, something nefarious was going on. But they do have sample test questions that teachers are to use to prepare kids for the type of tests that will be given. And those sample test questions are online and they're very revealing. And so that is a little more understanding than with the curriculum. As far as opting out goes, I am very much opposed to these check-the-box opt-out forms because, imagine this, you get a whole bunch of letters in your mailbox with a bunch of complaints about your landscape, and that somebody's checked off almost all the boxes, and you look at it, and half the boxes aren't relevant to anything in your yard. Are you going to pay attention to those letters from your neighbors? You're going to think, who's got a bug who's getting all these people organized to do this thing when they don't even know what's going on? But if you got a letter from your neighbors, and they each identified something that was specific, that was either dangerous or an eyesore in your landscaping, would you take that more seriously? Well, the school district is the same way, and it's a legal issue. If you send an opt-out letter and you've got a whole bunch of stuff checked off and the school district doesn't do half of it or they aren't using that specific test, the letter is legally null and void. So our opt-out letters look like letters. And you have to opt out as early in the year as possible. And you have to opt out one child at a time. You can't put all your kids from different grade levels on one letter. Each, especially if they're in different schools, but even if they aren't, they're both in high school or both in middle school, you want to have a separate opt-out letter for each child. And you need to call the school and ask them, what is the name of the test that they're using this year, and is it Common Core aligned? The Common Core aligned tests for Wisconsin and Minnesota are just coming online now. And in many of the states, especially the middle Midwestern states, they are not all functioning with Common Core yet because they're buying Common Core curriculum when their purchase cycle for new textbooks comes up. So there are several schools out there that are not going to be using any Common Core aligned Smarter Balance tests this fall. So you need to find out what tests your kids are actually going to be subjected to and opt out of that very thing. And there's a survey that's going on that's very objectionable. It's asking your kids about gun ownership and where is the gun located in your house and how much money does your family make and whether or not you've had sex and with how many different people and if they all been of the same sex. And that is a CESA survey. And the school district by law is supposed to send home a letter to all parents giving them an opportunity to opt out of that. But you know what kids are like. They don't remember to show you what's in their backpack. So it's kind of your responsibility to be aware of that. And there's a different survey for every grade level of kid. And it's called a little something different. So you want to find out if they're doing a health and safety survey at your child's school and what is the name of that survey and opt out of that survey. And then you'll be a lot more successful. And of course, the more people you have doing the same thing, the more effective it's going to be.